Well, welcome this beautiful afternoon. Thank you all for joining us. I'm Steve Morrison from CSIS. For many of you, this may be your first occasion to be here at our new building, and welcome. This is a new phase in CSIS, and as we move into our 51st, 52nd years, people here are very excited about this change, and I think it gives us all sorts of new opportunities to engage with our friends like yourselves. And so thank you for being here. The second point is congratulations to the editors and the authors to this volume that we're here to talk about today, Noncommunicable Diseases in the Developing World, Addressing Gaps in Global Policy and Research. And I hope you've had a chance to at least acquire a copy. Maybe you haven't had a chance to read through and digest it. I think, as we'll hear in the course of the presentations and the conversation today, this is a really important piece of work. Important, if only because it has asked some of the most fundamental questions about what is it that needs to happen in operationalizing a strategy on NCDs in low-income and lower-middle-income countries. What should the priority focal areas be, and how do we get there? And there are four or five key themes that I'm not going to preempt. Our speakers will hit on those today, both Lou and Jeff, on where the analysis carries us. But I think Lou and Jeff and the authors in the volume, I think you all deserve enormous credit for helping us think this through. It doesn't surprise me. Jeff has been an academic in his origins. And a medical and health academic before having a very distinguished career with Merck, and then a career in the Global Health Council, and now with Raven Martin. And this is in your genes, man. This sort of thinking and analysis, convening, getting people focused around, thinking hard and putting words on paper in a clear and very intelligible and forceful way, and so congratulations. And of course, partnering with Lou Galambos from Johns Hopkins University, and this has been his life in producing these kinds of very forward-looking and visionary analyses. He's a professor of history at Johns Hopkins University. He co-directs the Institute for Applied Economics, Global Health, and Study of Business Enterprise. We are gathered here really today to hear from the two of them and then to have a broader conversation. And we've been very fortunate having Sally Cowell join us, who's the Senior Vice President for Global Health at the American Cancer Society, familiar to many of you for the decade of her work at PSI, and before that, all of the different work that she did stretching back to as a career diplomat, as a deputy director at UNAIDS, as a key personality on matters pertaining to Cuba, and on and on and on. And Trevor Gunn, who's the managing director on international relations at Medtronic, also a good friend, also a person who brings enormous sort of intellectual weight. He's an adjunct professor at Georgetown, a PhD from London School, a trade expert, a public health expert, and a geopolitical strategist. So we have quite a combination of backgrounds and expertise to come to this conversation here today. And what we're going to do is ask Lou to kick us off today with some opening 8 to 10 minutes of presentation around what does this mean and where do we look forward from here. And then we're going to turn to Jeff to offer some additional remarks around the volume and where it points us. And then we'll turn to open things to a conversation, and we'll have Sally and Trevor help us kick that off. And then we're going to turn it to you and ask you to join that conversation, and we'll try and get to that point fairly rapidly. So without any further ado, I would like Lou to open us up this afternoon. Welcome, Lou. The floor is yours.
Thanks a lot. It's good to be here. It's a beautiful day. Frequently, you get a lot of bad news in the newspapers. I still read a newspaper, two of them. And So I have some good news for you to start out with, and that is that the biggest major in undergraduates at Johns Hopkins University is now public health. Mm-hmm. I have 126 students in a course on the history of global public health since World War II, and it's a joy to teach them. A lot of them have direct experience. They've done internships, and so it's a marvelous experience. Great enthusiasm. So I'm really happy to be here, and Jeff and the other contributors want to thank Steve and his team, and in this beautiful place. Wow, I'm blown away. So it's a nice place to be. But some of the news is not good. As most of you know, non-communicable diseases, which is our subject matter, which includes cardiovascular disease, diabetes, asthma, chronic respiratory infections, and cancers, are the leading causes of disease worldwide. An estimated 36 million people, this is a stunning number, die from such diseases each year. And what is less commonly known, and certainly among my students, is that 80% of these fatalities occur in low and middle income countries. So it's not distributed evenly over the world. These statistics are stark, and they hide, I think, the human toll and what this does to societies. In 2010, cancer alone killed 8 million people. And the picture is similar for other NCDs. 1 in 4 deaths globally from heart disease or stroke, 1.3 million deaths from diabetes. Current trends continue, there'll be a 17% increase in the NCD burden over the next decade. Africa, for instance, and by that I think my main reference is to sub-Saharan Africa, will see a growth of more than 25%. The absolute number of deaths will be greatest in the Western Pacific and Southeast Asia regions. The good news is that many of these fatalities are preventable, both through programs that aim at reducing high-risk behaviors, tobacco use, alcohol abuse, poor diet, sedentary lifestyles, and at creating better environments. Progress can be made there through improved treatment and service delivery for patients who need now chronic care. Cost-effective interventions to reduce the burden of these diseases exist, and sustained action can prevent millions of premature deaths. Most of the medications that are needed are now off patent and can be used in generic form, which makes a tremendous difference in terms of cost, as you know. A global movement for action on NCDs has been gathering momentum in recent years. Now, largely because of the efforts of people like you in this room, who have an interest in the issue and are looking ahead. The UN General Assembly passed a resolution on the prevention and control of NCDs in 2010. It's very interesting in teaching a history course to watch a series of movements develop and to watch how it gathers force and the number of people and institutions around it. And there's usually a great surge and then a turn in the movement. So it's wonderful to watch, and one of the things I like to teach is that some of it has elements of contingency, and leadership still matters. Everybody thinks of the great environmental forces that shape all of this, and they are important. There are economic and political factors, but also leadership shapes this, and we try to bring out some of the leaders when we do this. This is a global movement, though. In September 2011, the UN convened a high-level meeting that you know about that led to the adoption of a political declaration that laid out a clear plan for global surveillance, monitoring, and the things that would help that, and a health system response to prevent and control NCDs. In May, just of last year, the 65th World Health Assembly set the first voluntary global targets for a 25% reduction in premature mortality from NCDs, and the target there is 2025. Last month, the World Health Organization issued a draft terms of reference for the UN Interagency Task Force on the Prevention and Control of Noncommunicable Diseases. I want to get the title right. And this week in Geneva, right now, the WHO has convened a member state consultation on a proposed global coordinating mechanism to support work on the global NCD movement. As we'll talk about this afternoon, there are clear roles for civil society and the private sector to work together with the public sector in answering this call to action. In 1978, and you had Alma Ata, and you had a call for action, but it did not include the private sector. You couldn't do that at that time. In 2000, you could, and today you can, and today you have to. And so I think multi-sectorality is a very important subject. So there's a clear roles, I think, defined for the private as well as the public sector. Policymakers need to decide how best to incorporate NCD responses into existing funding streams, money matters, and programs. The path forward on NCDs is and will always be contested. There'll be debates, critiques, they'll continue to pour out, while healthcare workers will continue to implement and refine a set of rather ambitious, measurable, time-bound, achievable targets and metrics on NCDs. The global monitoring framework will provide accountability if governments and their partners implement and support independent mechanisms to track progress and build capacity for coordinated multi-sectoral actions at country, regional, and global levels to fulfill the commitments that have been made in 2011. These actions should develop along four related lines. First, there'll be efforts to achieve better integration with other health system priorities. Second, this will be accompanied by new efforts for implementation of best buys. That is, we do have to pay attention to cost all of the time. The proven cost-effective interventions that can help prevent NCDs or to treat those that are most prevalent. Third, integration and implementation will require attention to innovation. This has been for the last 40 years my major subject of interest, which is innovation in the public, private, and in the nonprofit sector and the way they work together when it works. And so this is an extremely important potential for development in the future. Things like polypills, comorbidities, the things we can do that bring things together and make it better, make better use of our resources. A new multi-sectoral partnership will address this. Fourth, as always in healthcare, there'll be a search for additional investment. There will be a search for money so that adequate resources are available to meet these NCD challenges. This was the context in which Johns Hopkins Institute for Applied Economics, Global Health, and the Study of Business Enterprise, and in this we were led by Jeff, no doubt. Jeff is a formidable leader in this regard, and he helped us get the Institute involved to make actionable recommendations. That was our goal, to come up with something. We all had a general picture of what to do and sort of what needed to be done. We wanted to translate that into actionable recommendations. The members of the NCD working group included Sir George Elaine, Robert Black, Johns Hopkins, Felicia Nall at Harvard Global Equity Initiative, Margaret Crook, Mailman School, Sonia Nishtar, Heartfile Pakistan, Richard Lang, who helped us, Soren Matke at the RAND Corporation, Kenji Shibuya at Tokyo University, and Brian Whitegay at the University of Montreal. Also Prashant Yadav at the University of Michigan. Jeff and I were also part of this working group. We built on the 2011 RAND report on improving access to medicines for non-communicable diseases in the developing world. The working group decided very quickly to focus on these five specific areas. These were accelerating regulatory harmonization, an important subject which has tremendous political aspects, structuring supply chains more effectively, improving access to interventions, restructuring primary care, and promoting multi-sectoral action. And that brought out the book. That's what the book is focused on, which Jeff and I co-edited with Rachel Calvin Whitehead. It's the product of a kind of collaborative dialogue among the members of the working group. It identifies what needs to be done and offers a framework for how to approach this work. Now I'll turn over to Jeff, who's going to provide you an overview of the book's recommendations. Thank you.
Thanks, Lou. So I'll just take another couple of minutes to walk us through in a little bit more detail what the recommendations are from this this collaboration that Lou talked about. And also, I'll be surprised if you don't tell us when you have a chance to intervene later that we've missed something that's really important. And I, you know, as I said, I won't be surprised because we aren't suggesting that these five areas are the only things that need to be done. These are five pragmatic recommendations for things that can be done now to really move this agenda forward. So the first, as Lou mentioned, Brian Whitegay from the University of Montreal has a chapter that talks about regulatory reform. And you know, when we think about access to health technologies, particularly access to medicines and vaccines, it's fair to say that a lot of attention focuses on how affordable they are in lower and middle income countries. But the reason that regulatory review is so important is if the medicines aren't available in those countries, there's not much you can do, whatever the price is. As we know from experience, for instance, with getting HIV medicines into Africa over the last 10 or 15 years, because Africa has 54 different regulatory bodies, it often is a challenge to make sure that a given antiretroviral is available to everybody who might need it across the continent. So that's why regulatory reform is so important. And this comes under two headings. Lou mentioned regional harmonization, which is one possibility, and there are many initiatives along these lines, and the chapter provides much more detail on this. But the idea there is that if you're a small country like Togo, it may not be necessary for you to have as rigorous a review in Togo as you might if you were South Africa or the United States, for that matter. And that there are, through the regional economic groupings like SADC and COMESA and the others, there are initiatives now that the African Union is also trying to bring together in a harmonized way so that a country like Togo can really depend on review, the technical review that's done elsewhere, and then just make sure that that's consistent with their own regulatory and legal framework. But it would be a much more efficient way of ensuring that medicines can get to more people. Rather than having 54 reviews, there might be a harmonized review on a regional basis. And this applies as well in Asia and Latin America. The other point is capacity building, and that, obviously this audience thinks about capacity building in many ways. But here, the chapter really focuses on the possibility of stringent regulatory agencies working with, like the FDA and the European Medicines Agency, the Japanese FDA, working together with agencies in lower and middle income countries so that they can help build the level of skill in the national medical regulatory agencies so that they'll be able to do a better job on a range of things, not just the technical review of dossiers, but also, for instance, building laboratory capacity so that they can deal with questions of counterfeit and substandard medicines, which is a big problem that regulatory agencies in these countries face. The second area has to do with supply chains, and this is where Lisa Smith and Prashant Yadav from the University of Michigan have contributed a really interesting chapter. And what they do is step back from this question and really look at the structural obstacles that impede access to medicines and other medical supplies to people in developing countries. And they look at this from the manufacturer all the way to the patient. And the critical issues here are the fragmentation of supply, because in many countries there are just so many uncoordinated ways that medicines are imported and then made available that often you have poor economies of scale, poor coverage, and leakage from the supply chain. And so it just isn't the most efficient way to ensure that people get the commodities that they need. So they look at a variety of ways of solving this problem, for instance, accredited healthcare retail networks, and also wider use of differential pricing in a more systematic way. And so that's an important area. The next area that we focused on was what can we learn from the HIV epidemic that can be applied to NCDs? And this is where Soren Matke from the RAND Corporation had some interesting ideas. And he focuses on really two key issues. One is the importance of partnerships so that companies who are involved in helping to deal with NCDs can bring novel products to the market, that's the second point, so I'll get to that in a moment, but they can work together with other players in the healthcare systems to set up partnerships that will take advantage of skills that companies have and bring them together with community and government stakeholders to try to do a better job of creating programs that, for instance, will train community healthcare workers to help complement what doctors and nurses can do. They can think about ways of applying methods for improving adherence to therapy, which will help improve health outcomes. And a number of other examples that Soren gives. The other example, actually Lou alluded to in passing, it has to do with product innovation. And there, I think there are some interesting opportunities for work on what are known as polypills, where there are so many comorbidities in NCDs. People with diabetes will have high blood pressure. People with elevated cholesterol, may also have high blood pressure. So there actually are some initiatives already in looking at ways that you can formulate some of these medicines into one pill that will treat many conditions at once or several conditions at once. So that's another area. The fourth has to do with primary care, and people often say, I love all my children, I love all the chapters in the book, but this is probably the chapter that I like the most. Margaret Crook and Gustavo Nagenda and Felicia Knoll have written a really interesting overview of the way in which reconfiguring primary care can actually help us get more health for the money that's invested in health systems in lower and middle income countries. And they look at, just as Lou talked about, four I's of integration, implementation, innovation, and investment, they also look at four I's. Some of them are the same, integrating primary care across, this audience knows well the work that PEPFAR has done to build a platform that has really made it possible to much more efficiently treat people, not just with HIV and AIDS, but also to bring other interventions in, say, on maternal and child health, and also I think there's an opportunity to do this in NCDs as well. So they look at ways that you can integrate across the primary care platform to deal with a range of different conditions. They look at innovations in service delivery, for instance, how you can use community health workers for task shifting. They look at the importance of including communities and the voice of the patient in designing the programs that are going to provide improved primary care, and I think that's a really important point. And then the fourth is to look at the ways in which new information technologies can help extend the reach of primary care. And so they give some examples in Latin America and Asia and Africa where mHealth initiatives have actually done a good job of doing that. And then finally, there are two other chapters. One by Sir George Elaine and Sonia Nishtar looks at the importance of multi-sectoral and intersectoral collaboration. One of the things, they actually make a distinction between those two. Often they're used interchangeably. But what they say, first of all, they observe that the political declaration mentions at least 15 times the notion of multi-sectoral partnership. And it's interesting, one aside is that the political declaration may have said that, but it's interesting to me that when the WHO convened this member state consultation this week on the global coordinating mechanism, the first thing they did was decide that they didn't want anybody but member states sitting in the room. So that's, but we can come back to that. But what Sonia and Sir George do is make a distinction between multi-sectoral and intersectoral. Multi-sectoral would be a whole of government. This is the easiest way to talk about it, so that You know, you want to have not just the health ministries involved, but education and agriculture and sport and transport and communications, because, you know, all of those ministries, all of those sectors have something to contribute to health solutions. And then they talk about intersectoral cooperation, and here another way of thinking about that is whole of society. So it's not just the organs of government or an interagency approach within government, but you want to work with civil society and the private sector to convene partnerships or to create partnerships that can actually help to translate this mandate of the political declaration into practical action. And then finally, Stuart Gilmore and Kenji Shibuya from the University of Tokyo take up the same theme as one of the cross-cutting themes throughout the book, and they talk more about the importance of thinking differently about global health governance so that this kind of collaboration and coordination among sectors really becomes part of the DNA of work in global health, because that's a way in which we'll really have an opportunity to improve the equity and efficiency and responsiveness of health systems in NCDs as well as in other areas. So that, in a pretty big nutshell, are the set of recommendations that we offer. And we're, as Steve said, you know, we're offering this as a way to try to help focus, you know, what's been a very broad-ranging debate over the last couple of years into areas of work that will actually move us from better policy, which is important, but to translate that to programmatic action that will really help us reduce the burden of NCDs. So thank you, and I'll stop there.
Thank you very much. So you've focused us into these five areas. You've reminded us that political leadership, Lou, that political leadership is essential. You've hinted around that there's still quite a bit of residual antagonism and suspicion around the private sector, although the private sector remains absolutely essential to what is going to happen. And you've given us these five key points to think about. So, Sally, from the standpoint of the American Cancer Society, from your background at PSI and elsewhere, how does this framework look? And what would you argue needs to be, you know, from where you sit right now, what needs to be the sort of sharpening of priorities looking forward in lower and middle income countries?
Well, thanks very much, Steve. And let me join the others in congratulating you and CSIS on this beautiful new building. I must say, for many, many a lunch on the basement of K Street, it's awfully nice to be looking out at the trees. And I must say, more importantly, to have the same high quality programming that went on at K Street move over here to Rhode Island Avenue. So thank you very much, and thanks for the invitation. I think this is an enormously important book because it's so pragmatic. I've always been a fan of not sitting on your hands while wringing them. I mean, I think we need to get on with things, and we need to translate lofty ideals down to what can really work on the ground and what can governments do and what should they do to stop talking and start doing. And I think we know what to do in many cases, and this book lays that out very carefully. I guess the one, I'd make a couple of additional points, and it comes out in the book, but to my way of thinking, not quite strongly enough. And you wouldn't be surprised, coming from the point of view, I suppose, of the American Cancer Society, but you shouldn't be surprised from any point of view, that for me, if you don't do anything else, do something about tobacco. I mean, tobacco is the only risk factor which is common to all four of these large diseases that we've talked about. And it now accounts for 1 in 6 of the NCD deaths are tobacco related. There are 15,000 people a day who are dying from tobacco use, and another 1,000 who are dying from the effects of secondhand smoke. So tobacco is key. 600 million people who are alive in the world today, which is almost 1/10 of the world's population of now 7 billion, will die from tobacco, and half of them are now children. So way back to the 2011 high-level meeting, and I must say to CSIS's report going into that meeting, said, start with tobacco. It's a way to frame things. And it's been talked about, but it should be the lead engine, and I think we're not making enough progress on that. And that should be the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control exists. It's been signed by many nations. It's not necessarily being implemented. Even now, all around this town and other town, trade talks are going on. The tobacco trade is a key part of that. So I'd like to see some focus on that. As Steve mentions, I come from the AIDS world, really, to the AIDS world, and then to reproductive health, and now to non-communicable diseases. And I think from the AIDS epidemic, we learned a few things that are key here. And one of them is that money is crucial. You know, money alone isn't enough. But without money, you really won't do very much. And today, the spending on NCDs by international donors and by country governments themselves is nowhere near in proportion to the epidemic. So in 2009, the spending by the international, the official government money, going as donor money to support health programs, about 1% of that was going to NCDs, whereas globally, non-communicable diseases are about 45% of the disease burden, and in some countries, of course, very much higher than 45%. But 45%, and as this book points out, increasing to 75% over the next couple of decades. So the spending is lagging. That was true in the AIDS epidemic, too. I speak from somebody who goes way back in that to the time when priorities were otherwise, and it took real political will and real political commitment on the part of countries themselves and also on the part of donor nations to reverse that. So I think without the political will that you saw that led to the establishment of the Global Fund, which turned on the taps for money, we would not have made the progress in attacking the HIV/AIDS epidemic that has obviously been made all across the world. So I think we need to get the spending up there. I agree, certainly, that multi-sectoral, and I would not call them PPPs, but PPPPs, private, public, people, or patient partnerships. I think it's true in all diseases, but especially for these non-communicable things. I mean, you are your own risk factor in many ways, so we need to involve people. This is not something that can be done to you. It's something that you have to participate in, and certainly it's something that writ large, I think our industries and businesses, the private sector in healthcare is important at the community level. I know this certainly from my work at PSI, the sort of half of the healthcare in the world to low and middle income countries and to low and middle income populations is in fact delivered by the private sector. We also know the private sector supplies a lot of all of the products that we eat and the products that we use in our daily lives. So I think it's important that we involve the private sector in this conversation. And the final thing, and again, this alludes to the book when it talks about primary care, I think we ought to remember that really non-communicable diseases are a game changer in terms of the agenda on women's health that we have been pursuing for the last four decades. All of the MDGs are really measured around pregnancy, preventing pregnancy, preventing mortality from pregnancies, from unsafe abortions, from things concerning women and their reproductive life. And certainly it's important to continue focusing on those things. And in many countries of the world, the Sahel, for instance, Mali and Niger and other countries still have really, really, really high births per mother. And no one says that it isn't important to have people have the number of children that they want to have and have families of a smaller size. But in many countries, it's really cancer and other non-communicable diseases have overtaken pregnancy and HIV as the primary driver of death in women. The good news about the last 30 years and the really significant progress we've made in maternal health and in HIV and AIDS is it gives us so many more points to intersect with women throughout their life cycles. So we need to be capturing that. We need to be, when women come in for antenatal care, we certainly need to be testing them for gestational diabetes, for high blood pressure, preeclampsia. When a woman comes to have an IUD inserted, why wouldn't we do a cervical cancer screening? And then speaking as the only woman on this panel and also of a woman of a certain age, let me also say we need to talk about women beyond their reproductive years and to be continuing to involve women who are not only extremely vulnerable, but also in so many cases the supporters of their families and the providers of health care. We need to keep women healthier longer and keep them from dying prematurely. We know what to do, and there are lots of exciting movements that came out of the high-level meeting, like a Women and NCDs task force, that I hope we will be able to employ to make a real difference on the ground in communities and nations and families. So that would be my comment on this extremely valuable book.
Thank you, Sally. Medtronix has been really in a lead position for some time now in trying to stir discussions and get the alliance supported in the lead up to 2011 and partnering with lots of different institutions around the world to contribute to a greater training capacity, skill levels, understanding, applied research and the like. Trevor, you've been a very guiding hand in all of this process. How does this framework look to you? What would you add to it? How would you sharpen it up from your standpoint?
Adding is tough to do because it is, again, adding my congratulations to Sally's to the authors. Certainly, it's a path-breaking work. It certainly hits directly at the one of the fundamental problems is how misunderstood non-communicable disease is, and the fact that it most in the world would probably say it's not relevant to the emerging countries, and it hits directly at that theme. And I think that that's exactly where it ought to be. Perhaps it's more in the second category, Steve, of sharpening, that I'd make some suggestions. Certainly, I think that we need to get a right definition on multisectorality and intersectorality, however that's called, but I certainly want to compliment Sir George's continued leadership. That chapter in the book is a part of it with his co-author, and it's correct, as Jeff has said, I think that the private sector feels at times that we're just one big private sector and sort of lock us in a closet and don't come out. And maybe when we're screaming, you'll open up the door. And that's not the appropriate framework for the modern society in which what the major leaders of the world had in mind when they put those 15 references. I've heard 17 references, 15 references, but there are a lot of them. And if you look at the MDG Eminent Persons Report, Homi Hamras just down the street was the author of that. That's a major report in advance of the MDG goals. NCDs are well mentioned, and the role of the private sector equally critical to the success in those. So I always say, spell out the rules of the game, figure out what it is. I realize that there's a part of the private sector that certainly it's not welcome, and I probably have the same personal views exactly, consistent with Sally's on what that is. But there are a lot of other parts of the private sector and other organizations, educational institutions, architectural organizations. Look at, one of the most clarifying moments was when I visited Steve a little bit ago, and John Hammer, the president of this place, stopped in the hallway to talk to him, and he went into this extremely graphic discussion of how this actually building was built and how exactly they got LEED standards met. And that's not your normal discussion you have with a CEO of any organization, and you got to engage all these people in this discussion. It's got to be across sectors. We'll have no success if everyone isn't involved. Even if we disagree with each other, we need to be involved and we need to be sitting at the same table. And whatever we call it, Sally, whether it be PPP PPPP, or whatever we call it. And I certainly welcome the issue. The attitude, I think, is relatively the same, and putting the patient in the middle of it. And I certainly think that that's the right way. We're starting a new activity over at the Institute of Medicine. I'm proud to be on that part of that activity, where we are going to be sitting down, again, in that sort of multi-sectoral way to figure out what is the right way forward. And as you look at why PPPP, whatever they are done or not done, you really come down to this issue of conflict of interest, at the core, and really kind of, look, the financial services industry went through this, particularly after 2008. It can be done. There are reasonable ways to disclose these issues and disclose your conflicts as we start. I always disclose issues when we go into conversations where I go between, I'm on the Inc. part of the business, and when I cross over to the philanthropy part of the business. My colleagues have shown the leadership that you've seen on the philanthropy part of the business. They deserve the credit, but there's also legal lines and ethical lines that when I go back and forth between those lines, I'm very sharply always try to point out. And I do want to, and again, I think, Sal, you said it beautifully, which is that donors need to all participate. You know, Rachel Nugent, a dear colleague of mine, and Sir George, Rachel and I, particularly before the high-level meeting, would have these quarterly coffees, sometimes lunches, really healthy stuff in addition. And we would sit down and try to figure out what are the basic principles that we want to adhere to, that ultimately, some of which are actually embodied in the political declaration. And Rachel, who is now out at the University of Washington, did, a seminal report that deserves repetition that talks about 1-3% of global donors right now in the NCD space. It hasn't changed very much. But the reality is the epidemiology is changing much more quickly to the negative without that action. I think that, I always look at ourselves in the mirror, and I hope as an organization we always do that, and I say, okay, if we call for multisectorality, we call for the public sector, if this is a major public health challenge, if the public sector also participate, are we actually participating? I think some of us know that we've done a lot of things in this area, and they're well documented, and if we're happy to disclose any of the figures or results that we've got behind those. As I think most of you know, we've recently put a very major commitment on the street in the past 2 or 3 weeks that some may know in the room, which amounts to about $16 million over the next 5 years. That is a philanthropy commitment. We're very interested in local engagements. And we're not stopping there. But in a certain sense, we need the public sector truly to participate. It can't be, in a very strange way, I feel at times that we're leading the public sector. That's not a great place. We need the public sector alongside us. Even if we sometimes disagree or have issues, we all need each other. In a certain sense, it sounds trite, but the reality is that's the modern reality and what we need going forward for solutions here, Steve. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to offer just a few remarks and offer some sort of counter thoughts to some of these five areas and ask our participants to react to some of this, and then we're going to open things up. In terms of just a few remarks, we got through the last decade of explosion of commitment and interest around infectious diseases. This decade is still to be defined, right? And we did have the Global Burden of Disease report almost a year ago, which was, to my mind, a thunderclap. And in terms of the data, the analysis, the quality, what's happened since then. And now we have the move towards the post-2015 framework, the sea change of discussion now around universal health coverage. So we're in a different era, we're in a different decade, it's still to be defined. Work like this helps us to define that. So I think it's important to emphasize that. Now, on the 5 points, on the regulatory authorities piece, I think this is very timely. Yesterday we had Peggy Hamburg here from FDA. Dr. Hamburg has been a leader, joined with Brazil and many other regulatory authorities in trying to find a way forward of creating much higher levels of cooperation and capacity building across regulatory authorities. So the timeliness of this suggestion, I think, resonates with what's happening within our own government and many other governments where the regulatory authorities are looking at this. But I think we need to be very humble. The amount of confusion and data around the illicit marketplace is quite staggering. And it is a health security problem. And I think in terms of sharpening the argumentation, the resistance that we're seeing emerge across multiple areas and the inability and difficulty of engaging India and China meaningfully into this is fundamental. So I just put those out as cautionary points, but I think that this, you've identified a very quick evolving issue that is a priority in other places for many of the same reasons. On supply chains, another key area, and I think we need to be fairly realistic. Supply chains are a very useful device for supplying cash to political campaigns and to offshore accounts. Supply chains supply different value for different people, and the health sector has been a honeypot for years in low-income and lower middle-income countries for supplying value in other directions. And one has to ask, how do you turn that around? And where do we see, what does it take to correct that deep-seated set of habits of corruption and diversion, financing of political campaigns, and lining of offshore and inshore accounts. On the public-private partnership, this is very, the whole private sector issue, I think, it's very contested territory, it seems to me. This is the big puzzle that people have to grapple with, which is the antagonisms and suspicions concentrated around the food and beverage industries, the difficulties that pharma has on conflicts of interest and the like, the medical products industry that Trevor represents is perhaps better positioned to navigate some of those tensions and play more of a convening and intellectual leadership. But there are others, many others, obviously, within the food and beverage industry who have stepped forward. Perhaps we could hear a bit more about how do you move through this very contested terrain. On the prevention and primary care place piece of this, I think, only to say, I think that there is a sea change underway, and I agree with Jeff. This is the sweet spot, I think, for where change is really possible. If people are talking about universal health coverage, they're talking about expanding primary care access and the like. It's the foot in the door. It's a change of outlook and norms and political commitments that point people in that direction, and that's very good. On the integration issue, ag, transport, urban planning and the like, I would say even more powerfully, urbanization, if you look at those places that are facing galloping urbanization, that is where this possibility of integration and the absolute imperative of integration comes into force. And obviously China's dialogue with Jim Kim and the World Bank, looking at 150 million people moving into, in the next 15 years, moving into the coastal urban settings, and having to think in a much more multi-sectoral way about how do you prepare for this reality, because if you don't prepare, you're going to have an absolute catastrophe. And every government in Africa, every low-income government, fears fears in its own way that urbanization will overwhelm it in its own way if a peasant agriculture is not preserved, if other opportunities are not preserved. So I think there I would make that argument even more powerfully. I think that the framework you've put forward is I think those five organizing concepts are very valid, and they point us towards some really tough challenges. Perhaps I could ask Jeff and Lou to offer some thoughts, hear from Sally and Trevor, and then we can open the floor. So thank you.
Sure. Well, thanks to Sally and Trevor and Steve for those provocative and really interesting comments on my first reaction is that it just reinforces the conviction I've had for a couple of years now that this is such a rich and complex set of issues that we'd better figure it out, because the future of global health really depends on sorting these issues out in a way that leads to effective action. On just a couple of points I'll make on to draw together some of the things that that all three of our commentators said. I think I'll start where Steve ended with urbanization, and I, it's already the case that more than half the global population lives in cities, and that percentage is going to increase over the next 20 or 30 years. But the cities, I'd venture to say that most of us in this room, when we have a mental map of urban centers, we think of places like Washington, D.C., New York, London, Tokyo. But the cities in 2030, 2050, if you just think ahead to where these trends are going, we're going to see that most of the top 20 cities in the world in terms of population will be in China. It's places like Lagos, not London, that are going to be more like the cities of the future. I think it really makes sense for us to think about how to integrate the challenge of dealing with growing urban centers with making sure that, providing for the health of people living in those centers and the surrounding urban areas is really addressed in an effective way. Now, that sounds ominous on one level, but on the other hand, it really is an opportunity because one thing about cities is that it's easier to reach people in an urban center than it is to find all the people out in rural areas who live in, very small villages, and it just is much more complicated to reach them. That's one reason why we've seen a lot of attention recently to the last mile, that is getting health resources to people who are far away from urban centers. But I think it's, if you apply the Pareto principle, if we come up with solutions that will work in major urban centers, we'll really be able to help most of the population, and then we can also address additional ways to reach the rest. So I think that's really an important point. And the other thing I just want to say generally is, Sally and Trevor and Steve have all talked about the importance of partnership and collaboration, and many of you know that I spent 20 years in the pharmaceutical industry before I went to the Global Health Council, and now I try to help all kinds of clients solve puzzles they have around global health issues. But, one of the, I'll use the word conviction, a conviction I have based on that experience is that the problems that we face in global health now are so complicated and so, challenging to really deal with at scale, that a solution that focuses only on whether government is going to meet the challenge is unlikely to succeed. In the same way that a solution that focuses only on how the private sector can do it or communities can, find ways to organize themselves and take care of business on their own isn't going to work. I think the only way that we're going to be able to deal with this complex set of issues is to find a way to ensure that everybody who has something to contribute is part of the solution. And we can negotiate all of these difficulties around conflicts of interest, around the skepticism that that one sector may have about the other. If we just focus on finding something we can agree on to work together to solve, and then use that as the basis for trying different ways of working together, when you succeed with that, that gives you an opportunity to move on to the next thing. And over time, that just leads to more and more confluence of interests and convergence of activity around the big problems that need to have everybody engaged to solve. So I think those two points, I think, are the ones that stuck out to me from the discussion.
Lou. I will give you my note of personal involvement, and that is, I believe adherence is an enormous problem that's going to grow. It's bad enough in our societies, and it's going to be even more in the lower and middle income countries. And so I see primary care is the rate controlling institutional change, as I see it myself. And that's just a personal observance. Finally, about tobacco, I say that my sister died of secondary smoke and my father died of primary smoke. I've often felt that if I'd had a video of my father dying, it would discourage quite a few smokers. I didn't have that and wouldn't do that, but it is a crucial issue. So I'm really happy to see these kinds of suggestions bubbling up, because that's what we want to do. So thank you.
Trevor, and then Sally, and then we're going to come to our audience here. Trevor?
Right, and I want to hasten that discussion. So I'll just make one comment on...
turn your mic on.
Oh, sorry. Folks never said they had a problem hearing me, but there we go. For those that are remote, regulatory harmonization, I think, Jeff, you called it out, or someone else called it out. I think that really has to... I mean, all barriers, some of which are tremendously artificial to access, governments need to do their work, the private sector needs to do their piece when it comes to this, and this is where the regulatory harmonization piece, kind of bothers me a bit. Because if I look at the WHO map, which I have great respect for the work that they do, and I'll be into WHO Medical Devices Forum next weekend in Geneva presenting on trade agreements. But what I would say is, as I look at their map of countries that are regulated for medical devices, it looks like all the countries are regulated for medical devices. But the reality is only about 65 are actually regulated for medical devices that have any real competency. And I'm talking countries like Chile, who just decided, a very advanced country, who just decided to regulate medical devices, and it's still in draft form. And so I do see as well donors such as, colleagues that are doing great work over at the World Bank under a Gates-funded project that are working in East Africa, but that regulatory harmonization is only confined to drugs. Whereas I think the real mystery to solve is actually for devices that are not easily solved. We need to break down some of those artificial barriers and see what can be done in that particular area. Obviously, tariffs, we have something called the Information Technology Agreement, negotiations that are occurring as we speak in Geneva. It's another area that governments can, we can help, but there's limits to what we can tell the government. And we have to say that tariffs are a good source of revenue as well for those governments. But at the same time, they actually do prevent access to technology, to other services that actually may be able to bring slow the pace of some of the trends we've talked about.
Sally?
Just one very quick comment, and that's for all that I said, we need more investment by governments. I don't think there will be a global fund created for NCD, so I think that most of that investment is going to have to come from the private and public sectors in the countries around the world. And I think that effective advocacy and getting people involved in advocating for better or for worse, most countries in the world now are democracies, and they are at least somewhat responsive to the public will of their societies. And so I think we need to energize people in these countries to encourage their governments to invest. And governments have to think that the prevention and treatment of NCDs early on is really an investment and not a cost. There's a difference between a healthcare system and a sick care system. And governments, I think, would be smart to get on with that as soon as possible and to encourage the private sector and cities, which are walkable and preventing obesity and doing something effective about tobacco. But invest early and often, just like Mayor Daley said about voting, I guess.
Okay, why don't we, we've got a number of folks, we'll take comments and questions, we'll bundle together several. There's some hands in the back, so we'll start on the back side there. Lois,
okay.
And then we have three or four. We'll please be brief, please identify yourself.
Yes, sir.
Please be brief, we'll do four or five, and we'll start with those in and around you, Lois, so you kick us off.
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Lois Pace. I'm with the Live Strong Foundation. Very much appreciate Ambassador Kowal's final comment around there not being new money. So Live Strong Foundation, as people know, has been on the Hill, has been meeting with the administration, and what we continue to hear is how can we do more with less? And so I'm wondering, Jeff, you talked about there being an integration chapter. Are there specific case studies therein that explain how people can actually be doing, i.e. addressing NCDs now with the platforms and frameworks that we have, whether that's through maternal child health programs or through PEPFAR? There are only a few examples still. Partners in Health, Pink Ribbon, Red Ribbon. I need more in these meetings that I'm having with state, with the White House, and with congressional offices.
Thank you. just in front of you there.
Hi, Carolyn Pryor from Millennium Challenge Corporation. Nice to see you, Trevor. We had a non-communicable disease program health project in Mongolia that was very successful. And my question, we had a nearly $50 million budget, so we were very unique, I think, in the NCD portfolio field right now in terms of what we could do. And our advocacy spanned many different types of advocacy, including even a drama series, a soap opera of sorts, of 30 episodes regarding non-communicable diseases. And I was wondering what, in your experience, is the best way to get the people part, the advocacy that's worked in your previous experiences? Has radio been the solution, TV, public outreach campaigns? What works? Because we did so many different things, it's hard to discern what actually worked. It was successful, but we were able to spend so much money. Now, when I'm talking to other donors that are trying to work in this field, it's hard to say, oh, this is, and I understand, obviously, there's unique country context to all of this, but it's hard to say, oh, this is a good way to go, because we were able to do so much, fortunately. Thank you.
Yes, my name's Michelle Farmer. I'm with JPIGO. I just have a question. I mean, I want to thank you all for all the wonderful comments and the perspectives, very important areas and challenges. But one area that I haven't heard much discussion around is adolescents and young adults and the role of the need to try to address NCDs in this context. I mean, when we think about Best Buys as an example, doing a lot with prevention and early intervention with just a few dollars. I think that addressing the needs of adolescents and young adults age 15 to 25 would be a very important area, having a big impact on obesity, tobacco use, and a lack of physical activity, all as precursors to the major non-communicable diseases. So I'm hoping that you can make some comments about opportunities to intervene for our young citizens as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Right next to Michelle.
Thank you very much for a lovely presentation. My name is Manaus Harrison. I'm with Project 216. I had a Fulbright in Georgia, and the focus of my work being there was to develop the cancer control policy for, therefore I brought all this multi-sector, you name it, together to draft that. And it was coinciding with the UN 2011 September on NCD, therefore I became contributor and editor of their NCD. So I easily can say, working in that region with the folks, that they're very heavy, everybody has been very heavy with the influence of WHO, to actually regulate or perhaps just sign the policies. That's what I want to say. So signing the policy and then taking it to application, legislation, and implementation is where we actually do not have the capacity in those underdeveloped or developing countries. There is no institutional capacity or human capacity to deliver any part of that, from advocacy to prevention, name it. My office was in the Cancer Prevention Center, where the doctors and patients simultaneously smoke. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So true.
Okay, let's pause for a moment. Lois posed the question around, what are the examples of building off existing platforms? Where are the case studies of being able to do more with less and extend into the NCD range? Carolyn pointed us to the question around the people part and the innovations, radio, TV campaigns. Michelle's looking at adolescents, and Ms. Harrison posing this question about how do you address these gaps in policies. Jeff, you want to speak to a few of those, and then
sure.
We'll open it up for you guys to jump in on which piece of this you want to comment on.
Sure. Let me just make a comment on Lois's question. The chapter on primary care does have some other examples of where this kind of integration is working, and I think you'll find those useful. And the references point to some other examples that are there in the literature. I actually think, and you know, this is just my own opinion, but I think that PEPFAR is the best example we have of how integration is actually enabling the program to get more health for the money and to do more with less. Many of you are familiar with this, but I was speaking with Eric Goosby just before he stepped down to return to California. And if I remember the number correctly, and you know, Steve or others will correct me, but I think that in the last 4 years, they've tripled the number of people on antiretroviral treatment, and the budget has been flat. So that is a pretty powerful statement about how you can get more with less just by attending to the efficiency of how you deliver care and treatment, and also to make sure that you just get rid of duplication of effort and you know, really do the best you can with the materials, the resources that you have. Now, when you then expand that, and also part of what PEPFAR has done, in addition to getting more people on antiretroviral treatment, there are also tens of millions of people who are getting access to maternal and child health, to breast cancer and cervical cancer screening, and they're also looking at integrating other NCD interventions onto the PEPFAR platform in different countries. So I think that's the biggest and best example we have of how this can work. And the reason that it's so powerful is, if you just think about it for a minute, to the other comment you Ms. Harrison was making about Georgia, as in many other lower and middle income countries, there's a lack of institutional and human capacity. But part of the problem is that you'll have a cancer center here, you'll have a center that looks at maternal health here, you'll have, it's just all siloed kinds of interventions. And in each of those centers, you'll have investments in a variety of drugs, of equipment, of training facilities and clinic facilities, which could be used to provide care in other priority areas as well. And that's why figuring out a way to integrate planning, to integrate the use of resources, to integrate from the perspective of the patient, because after all, patients don't present with just one condition, they have often have multiple conditions, to figure out a way to do this so that it makes sense from the patient point of view and also the best use of the resources. Seems to me, Steve was asking, what's the next 10 years in global health going to look like? I think this is going to be a major focus over the next 10 years, because the only way that countries will begin to approach what they hope to do with universal health coverage is to make the best use of available resources, because Sally's absolutely right. I think there's a vanishingly small chance that we're going to see another global fund for NCDs, so we have to make the best use of the resources that we can mobilize. And so I think that this is really going to be the key set of technical and issues at the core of the move to universal health coverage.
Luke, of those four issues that were put on the table, can you harvest some nuggets out of the volume to point us to?
Yes. Well, out of both personal experience, I am the oldest single working parent with two teenage daughters that you have probably ever met. And I want to comment on adolescence. I have a lot of experience with that. And you have to go through the schools. That's the most cost-effective way. You have to get people at school age, and it has to be done through teachers who care. And that's much more effective than radio. They don't listen to your radio programs, they listen to theirs. And TV, they watch, but they have cleverly learned how to get rid of the commercials. And so that's my observation on adolescence. About cancer control and about the problem of unit capacity, I think that's a tremendous issue, and Jeff's touched on this. I think I'm a little more optimistic about that, and I'm a little more optimistic about money, but I think you get spillovers from all of these programs. You get spillovers from clinical testing, and I think those are extremely important. They're hard to measure, but I think if you look at what's happening on the ground, that's what you see. So I think that that's going to be probably more effective in a certain sense than some kind of major rationalization of a program. I think that a lot of these programs where there is a breakdown in communication between parts of the treatment program, I think that that's a major problem. But I think it's really hard to rationalize these, in part because you change everyone's job.
Sally?
Thanks, Steve. Just two comments quickly about adolescents. To Michelle's question, I think the cost-effective things that you can do are adding HPV vaccine for both girls and boys, especially for girls. And now some data out this week shows that as little as one dose rather than the three-dose regimen may be effective. The price for Gavi-eligible countries is now down to $5 per dose, so even at three doses that may be affordable. In non-Gavi countries, certainly in this hemisphere, through a very innovative PAHO, Pan-American Health Organization, negotiation with the drug companies, I think the price is $13 per dose. Mexico has already reduced it from the regimen from three doses to two doses, so I think it's becoming, again, political will being extremely important. We've seen that in even Texas and other places. I mean, you have to want to do it, but then I think the resources are there to do that. And male circumcision, which we know has a huge impact on HIV, also has an impact on HPV. So I think those are two relatively low-cost interventions for adolescents that would make a big difference. The other thing I would say is how important it is to have correct data. I mean, one of the things we learned in the HIV epidemic at the beginning, and I was with UNAIDS, was that everybody had their own data. Countries had data, Harvard had data, WHO had data, UNAIDS created their own data, and nobody could agree on the data. It was an important point for advocacy and for fundraising to get some agreement on the data. So I think to the point about cancer control and cancer registries, I know that for cancer, I assume it's true for other NCDs, terrifically important to know what you're looking at, what your population is facing, to begin to design cost-effective interventions to really take advantage of those best buys that you may have available to you.
And I'll jump perhaps on two of the questions, if you don't mind, Steve. Just so, first of all, to compliment MCC on their leadership, and Carolyn, for your leadership, who would have ever thought that that leadership would have played itself out in faraway Ulaanbaatar? But there we are, and you guys have done a great job. I'm sorry you're wrapping it up, and hopefully there'll be more. But I mean, tying at the core of it, the issue of, and I think Sally, you hit on this. I think there's a lot more discussion, and we'll be having a discussion on the Hill next week, specifically on this topic of tying this whole discussion to growth and how NCDs actually tie into growth. Now, we know that health to wealth or health to growth is not an always easy argument to make, but I also know not enough thought has been put into it, and I think that's very, very important. But you didn't ask that question. You asked the question about what messages are the most important, and I would say two. Employer to employee, and peer-to-peer. And what I mean, and people don't think about this, but if you think about, you know, our employment problems here in the United States, 7%, 8%, that means that a lot of other people are unemployed. And guess what? They're listening to their bosses. And organizations are creating great incentives. And if you're not hearing messages and actually getting incentives like Discovery, the Vitality Group covers under Discovery, to actually get healthy food, I got an email from my folks today, fill out this health questionnaire and you'll get, $100 off on your, health insurance this year. Those are all good things. And I think that's a very powerful medium because there's a perception issue that just doesn't want to go away and they keep on emailing it to you until you relent. Peer to peer, I don't think I have to talk to more, but I think that's a very, very, and even if you, poo-poo some of the efforts that the private sector is making, I think you would understand that that's a very important channel. I don't care if you're a government employer, you're a private sector employer, NGO employer, I don't care who you are. I mean, that's going to be a very important channel. And Michelle, I want to come down and hug you for that question from Jopaigo, because a colleague of mine from our philanthropy and myself were the people that really were kind of the movers behind a specific project. Jeff Mears here, the co-chair, together with my colleague Justin Custer of the NCD Roundtable. But you were directly involved in something that we helped to start called NCD Child. And, I can tell you how many discussions I've had with UNICEF over the years about this discussion. You wouldn't want to You need a calculator. Let's just put it that way. And it is so commonsensical. If we're going to talk about prevention, what is more commonsensical than talking to kids about the right things? And what is more important than the mother-to-child or father-to-child communication pattern when it comes to this? Let's use common sense. We don't need to start with, you know, advanced medical technology. We need to start with good common sense. NCD Child, I think we're largely the lone funder of that, and led by a visionary woman down under by the name of Dr. Kate Armstrong. And Jeff, you're on that. And UNICEF is actually on the board, thankfully. And I think it's their window into this discussion. I don't think you can get any better marketing vehicle than UNICEF in the world. And we're very proud to be associated with it. But we need help. We need people that are actually interested in this activity. NCDchild.org, okay? And we need other companies, organizations of all shapes and sizes to be active, educate on this effort, and active on this effort. And it, so the exact products are Facts for Life. Right? It could be a global publication that's going to talk about some of those commonsensical things that we consider common sense, but may simply not be common sense in other parts of the world. Those are very important. There are a lot of other very practical things that have come out of it. Some have already been produced, and you know, we need all in on this one. So thank you for that question.
Thank you. We're down in front here. If we could have, why don't we take, we'll collect some comments over in this quadrant. Yes, please identify yourself.
Crystal Lander, Management Sciences for Health. And I have two quick questions, both I hope are challenging. The first one is, we talked about PPPPs. I love that, Sally. Question is, other than tobacco, what industry would you not want to partner with on NCDs? And then the second one is related to PEPFAR. I was in DC when we worked on PEPFAR 1 and 2. It was not easy, but PEPFAR 1 had very clear goals. What do we want to accomplish? As PEPFAR goes into its phase two, or really phase three, it's looking at what do we want to accomplish now? Things have changed a lot. So the question I'm asked on the Hill often is, what do you want to accomplish with NCDs? And for us, that's challenging. It's a lot of things that fall into it, but it's something that we clearly need to answer. So what do we want to accomplish? What would success look like?
Thank you. And here we had a question here, hand up right here, and then over here.
Thank you. My name is Amit Chandra. I sit on the board of the African Federation of Emergency Medicine. And my question to the panel is how you see acute care services and pre-hospital care fit into this discussion. And on a related note, how you see injury prevention and the issue of road trauma specifically fit into the non-communicable diseases debate. Thank you.
Thank you. Right here. And then Keith behind you.
My name is Laurent Hubert with the Framework Convention Alliance. And almost over 10 years after adoption of the FCTC and almost 9 years after its entry into force, implementation is fairly low. And some people argue that if we were able to, and also even at country level, there's a lot of incoherent positions, like the Czech Republic, for example, on one side ratifies the FCTC, adopts a tobacco bill, on the other side it's involved in a trade challenge against Australia in support of Philip Morris. So some people are arguing that integrating NCDs and tobacco control in the post-2015 development agenda could help create more coherence at national level. So I would be curious about what type of indicators would you think are appropriate in the post-2015 development agenda, whether it would be universal health coverage or extended life expectancy, overarching goal, and what type of NCD target and then indicators would you like to see under that? That was one question, and the other one is about tax and fiscal policies, which have been identified as Best Buy, but also could be a source of resources for implementation of NCD policies at country level.
Thank you. Keith, right behind
you. Thank you very much for your timely presentation, and Steve, for organizing this, this get-together. We know what to do to deal with these challenges. We have a mountain of evidence, whether it's economic or others, to know what to do to address NCDs. So my question is, what are the obstacles and how do we overcome the mainstreaming of public health into primary care plus? And the plus being access to basic surgical care, which will deal with the issues you're talking about, the issues of help to address maternal health and to address the disability tsunami that's going to hit us as part of the NCDs. So the obstacles and how to overcome them. Thank you.
Okay. Let's take one more right here. Please. And then we'll come. We have time for at least one more round here. Yes, please.
Yeah, thanks, and thanks for this stunning panel. I'm learning a lot right now. I'm from FHI 360, Antje Becker-Benton. I'm working in health communication. And my question is to Sally and others, what have we learned in this area from the HIV epidemic for NCDs? Because one of the biggest mistakes we've made is to individualize risk and not look at social, cultural context and economic context of behaviors. And what is planned to be done differently for NCDs in this area?
Who would like to jump in on this?
Well, I have one suggestion. Actually, it relates both to this question and the one that raised a couple of other issues around, like road accidents, which, in some countries in Africa at least, are the largest killer of children under five. So it's and you're right. It often isn't mentioned in discussions around NCDs. I think one of the things that we learned from the HIV epidemic, and Sally may want to jump in here as well, is we really began to make some progress in a more systematic way. After the money had been raised, so you went from the millions to the billions. But then I think that when the three ones were introduced, along with the mantra to know your epidemic, I think that really helped to ensure that countries were able to take a systematic look at the issues that they faced. And that helped in allocating resources so that you could really make progress on getting more health for the money. So, and the three ones, some of you will recall, were to have one national plan for how to deal with the epidemic, one national agency to coordinate all the efforts, and one monitoring and evaluation framework. So this gets back to the point that Sally mentioned about you can't do this if everyone has his or her own data. You have to have one common framework. And that applies as well to NCDs. Now, many of the countries in lower and middle income countries are developing their NCD plans. That was part of the work that was put in motion by the WHA when they adopted the Global Action Plan. And so in the course of doing that, I think that the question of how you can coordinate acute care with chronic care, how you deal with mental health issues, with road accidents, with injuries, as well as the NCDs that we've been talking about today, whether you deal with the elderly population, with kids, or with adolescents, all of that's going to look different on a country-by-country basis. You can't make any categorical statements that will actually help people deal with the issues in front of them. So I think that insight from the success in the latter stages of the global response to the HIV epidemic is going to be important over the next couple of years for dealing effectively with NCDs at the country level.
Thank you. Sally, you want to jump in?
I don't really have much to add. I think I would say that it is really important to integrate things and to get patient empowerment for dealing with a lot of these things. I mean, one of the things I think the American Cancer Society does very successfully, and I think probably other groups as well, is sort of help patients with navigation, just help you know whether you come in through acute care or however you come into the medical system, how to navigate that, how to get the services that you need. I think that's going to be important as we go forward.
Industry question.
I'll answer your question. I mean, there were two sort of related questions. Our colleague, our medical colleague here, and also our colleague over here, Keith, I think, because I heard the first name, but I didn't understand your organization, by the way. Oh, CUGH, okay, very good. So that makes a lot of sense. All right. I think they're sort of tied. And let me give you a medical technology perspective. Hopefully that's relevant to public health. I mean, so if you look at our philanthropic commitment that we've announced, our new sort of $16 million commitment, it's very focused on building up frontline health workers, very much health systems perspective, trying to build up that front end, and that's particularly necessary in emerging economies. But certainly, I think a lot of companies, a lot of organizations, my colleague is here from GE Healthcare, Marianne Ring, there's a lot of other companies that are here, and also public and private sector actors, universities all working together are building out secondary care, tertiary care. We as a medical technology company, we know a little bit about exactly the incidents that you're talking about. Manufacturing 71,000 technologies gives you that right to talk about that. But we know that we need to change our business models. We've got thankfully, at least in our company, we've got a Bangladeshi CEO that very much is concerned about exactly the problems that you're talking about. So you've got to change your business models. You've got to make technologies that are simply more relevant. We've just announced 2 weeks ago a kidney dialysis version of what GE Healthcare did relative to ultrasound, but doing it for kidney dialysis, a portable kidney dialysis unit, which could be put up in your overhead airplane hangar. That is, instead of 300 liters of water, it's going to take three. Those type of things that happen in India and other such fine places in the world. You've got to change the technology landscape. We're well in advance in trying to do that, but we're still in the early stages of the game. And it goes on and on. So I'd say that a lot of things have got to change in the public health arena, and that is just the absolute resolute lack of doctor capacity. Forget about surgical teams. You know it well. We're talking about just resolute lack of doctor capacity at secondary and tertiary healthcare levels in vast majorities of countries. And we think that those investments are also necessary. We're going to be a partner in making those investments along with the public sector. Let governments themselves decide which direction to go. Certainly in Africa, tremendous amount of the healthcare is already being delivered by the private sector, so that's not an intellectual debate for them. You know, wherever the best care is got, you don't simply have to jump on the next BA flight to go to London to have that done. It should be done locally, and you should have that operation with your family in present, as opposed to at great distance when these type of things happen.
Lou, you have a comment?
I think what cuts through all the questions is how do you get a movement started? And I think my own view historically is that you're right now at the point where the highly generalized discussions, the affirmation of the need has taken place at an international level. And you're now moving into a period when, as this book did, we hope, was things get much more specific and you look for solutions in part of the world, not the entire world. And it seems to me you also look for the resources in the same way. You look for success, then you're looking for some success stories that sustain resources. People don't like to give money. If you talk to a development officer, people don't like to give money because you're in distress. They like to give money because you're succeeding. And so those, I think, will come out. And that was one of the important results, I think, of the Gates and Merck combination in Botswana was to give a demonstration of what could work. And I think that's going to happen, that we're right now at that phase. And so that's, I think, the way we see the book.
Down in front here is a person who would like to, do you have a microphone? We have a microphone. Jeff has been patient. No, let's get a microphone. Jeff's been patiently, and then here and Sam, and we'll come. So yes.
Okay. Thank you. Stop talking and start doing. I appreciate your comment, Sally. My name is Kelly Buchanan Gelb. I'm director of operations at a company called Anywhere. We are working to bring medical instrument sterilization to the developing world that is portable and power-free, addressing treatment of NCDs through central surgery. My question is, what kind of advice could you give to a company in product development phase who is willing and already talking and collaborating with both ministries of health in Africa and co-designing with patients?
Jeff, and then in front here, and we'll come to you, Sam, in a moment. Just a second, yes.
Thanks. Jeff Meir, the Public Health Institute. Congratulations on a great panel. A little commercial, which Trevor already preempted, but Justin Kester from Medtronic and I co-chair a group called the NCD Roundtable that meets in Washington once a month. For many of you are members of this roundtable. It's very focused. It's dedicated to Washington, D.C. based advocacy. Sally, we will welcome your participation now that you're at ACS. So if you have questions about this, you can go to our website, ncdroundtable.org, or see one of us after the meeting. My question is, we talked about a bunch of donors today. We talked about the private sector. We talked about philanthropy. We talked about governments. We didn't talk about international financial institutions. And I'm wondering if anybody on the dais would care to comment on the role. Sally, you touched on it a little bit with PAHO, but it's broader than that. It's the bank, it's all the IFIs, and they are not lacking in funding. So would love to hear your perspectives on that. Thank you.
So we have one question from Ariella through Twitter. How/where do your recommendations converge or diverge from the current post-2015 discussions?
Hello, I'm Elizabeth Ransom, and I just finished 5 years with the University Research Company, International Health Company. I'm going to be starting work with the U.S. government public health initiative next week, pending my security clearance. And I want to thank you for an excellent panel and a wonderful discussion. One of my questions is, I noticed that no one mentioned the serendipitous timing of today's panel, and I wonder if anyone knows what public health issue is highlighted today.
It's World Diabetes Day.
World Diabetes Day, that's right. And I wanted to mention it because it's the day that Charles Banting invented insulin. And for me, this is a very important day because without insulin, I would not be alive. And so I'm between jobs, so I'm here as the P, the fourth P in the model that Sally mentioned. So the other question my professional hat is, I'm a communicator. And I'm wondering about the name. I've been so excited about this NCD movement, but non-communicable diseases. It says what you're not, but not what you are. And I'm wondering if you might consider re-looking at the nomenclature.
Thank you. Can you just hand that to Sam here?
Samuel Denny Jones. Stand up. If you can forgive
me.
I don't know. Trevor might remember that when you had the meeting about 2 years ago, I asked the same question. And the issue, you said that there might not be a global fund for NCD. What if there was? What would you actually use the money to do? And that is a difficult question. And at that time, it was posed differently. The lesson I learned from HIV/AIDS and from malaria as well, was that the money came, but by the time the money came, there was a clear consensus, evidence-based consensus, on what a package of activities you could put together and what outcome you would get. If you remember, PEPFAR was called 2710. It was very clear that you had to treat 2 million people, about 7 million infections, and care for 10 million. The outcomes were very clear, and how to get to those outcomes were clear. Do we have a clear set of activities, not broad consensus, not broad framework on what these activities could be, that you could put together so that a donor would say, look, I'm not willing to fund concepts and frameworks, but I can fund activities that would lead to these outcomes and hold you to those outcomes.
You're going to set off a very interesting fight.
Hi, Lee Yerkes, I'm retired. Sorry I was late, and I apologize if these 2 points were covered. I was involved in the initial procurement of U.S. government-funded for antiretrovirals, pre-PEPFAR, in 3 test countries, Ghana, Rwanda, and Kenya, and fortunately that was successful, and PEPFAR resulted from that. But I was very interested to hear Jeff's comment about and I'm not surprised that the number of patients on therapy supported by PEPFAR has tripled with no increase in funding, because I know the cost of treatment has come down significantly. But I have 2 very quick questions. Number one, what has been the impact of the successful HIV/AIDS treatment programs on the advent of NCDs among that population? And number two, has there been a look, have we looked at integrating the diagnosis and treatment of NCDs in that target population and at those very successful treatment sites? Thank you.
I'd like to suggest, we'll come back, I think we'll have time for another round. What I'd like to suggest is we start at Sally and just work our way down here. Sally, would you like to? And just pick off whichever pieces of these multiple questions you care to address.
They're all really good questions, and I feel like we could be here all night, which would be great. I think the certainly in the HIV/AIDS epidemic, the international financial institutions began to play a big role. And if you look back at the World Bank already put out a paper in 2011, I mean, my feeling about all of these things is that they're political institutions as well. They're not just run by their management, they're run by their boards. Their boards are the people who represent the U.S. government and the U.K. government and all of the other governments who are donors to them. I also have a career in the U.S. government, and I know that there isn't necessarily unanimity among U.S. government institutions, so I think somebody has to be really pushing on the U.S. executive director to the World Bank and to the Inter-American Development Bank and all the rest of these things. But it's like turning around Queen Mary's. It takes a long time. It took a long time between when it was beginning to be recognized that there was an out-of-control HIV epidemic going on in sub-Saharan Africa and when the funding really flowed. So I agree with Lou. I think we're somewhere in the development of that, and it's actually history repeats itself, you know, as tragedy and farce. But I'm hoping that we will have learned that delay doesn't serve anybody, and we need to work on it faster. To the question about sterilization and being able to do that, I think it's terrifically important. I mean, surgery is going to be and we look at all the low-hanging fruit, and that certainly prevention is a low-hanging fruit. Some of the things that don't need surgery seem easier to do, but I think certainly in cancer, we need to have surgery. And I think that can't be sustainably done by five doctors from Harvard flying in for a week and feeling good about it and then leaving. I mean, we have to be able to transfer those skills, and the skills are not only the skills to do the surgery, but the skills are how to maintain the environment in which that can be done sustainably. But I think every country will need some tertiary facilities to be able to handle these kinds of things. So, you know, I'll leave it there. I mean, on diabetes treatment, I had forgotten that today was World Diabetes Day and how important insulin is to that. But we also know that insulin, the price of insulin varies so incredibly widely throughout the world. To get some conversation going, and also the kind of how will we get diabetes treatment insulin out to people who need it? Is that a kit where you can buy at a fairly low cost both the syringe and the insulin and package it the way we've been able to package some of these other things? That's part of what the book talks about, but I think insulin is going to be extremely important to facing that.
Thank you. Lou, would you care to speak to some
of
the issues?
Yes, just very quickly, I think that integration of activities is going to be extremely important in this, what I see as this first phase. And we are just at the point where we're trying to make things specific and where specific experiments or attempts are going to be made. So I think that if that works at the primary level, that the effects will come up, it seems to me, to the secondary, to what in the British system is the secondary level and maybe to the third level ultimately. That's going to involve changes in education in other countries, and these are going to be relatively expensive. Again, the model that's talked about in the book about supply chain integration and about integration or harmonization of regulation is going to be one of the factors that's going to make that possible, because every country is not going to be able to train all of the doctors, all of the nurse practitioners, and all of the technicians that they need. So I think that the movement that started in this way is going to force change along those lines.
Thank you. We had Elizabeth ask about the name. Our web person asked about how does this all fit in the post-2015 agenda.
Sure. One reason, Elizabeth, when you asked this question about can't we call non-communicable diseases something else, is that everybody who's been advocating around this for the last several years has wished they had a better answer to that question. So if anyone has any bright ideas, I'm sure we'd all like to have a different name than non-communicable diseases, that we're actually for something. So, but let me just comment quickly on a couple of these very good questions. You know, Kelly asked a question, what advice can we offer to a small company that's trying to start up in this area? And I think actually the question that was posed about international financial institutions by Jeff is part of that answer. Just to give you one example, I mean, first of all, the World Bank and the other IFIs are, you know, massive institutions with a whole range of issues that they're working on. I think that the timing right now, given Jim Kim's new strategic direction for the World Bank to end extreme poverty and also to address poverty in middle-income countries as well as in the lowest-income countries, and given Jim Kim's background in trying to reconfigure global health himself for, you know, before he went to the World Bank, I think that it's an interesting juncture for trying to encourage the bank to take a look at how to integrate health into more of the work they do. And through the IFC, you know, they created an Africa Health Fund a couple of years ago along with other other donors. And I remember in talking to the people who were responsible for that, what worried them was that they'd put this money out there, several hundred million dollars, to try to help small and medium enterprises do more for health in lower and middle income countries, and they just couldn't find any projects to invest in. So there's an opportunity for you, is to see whether you can persuade them that they should invest in your project. And then because it's World Diabetes Day, I just want to make a comment about that. You know, right now there are more than 370 million people around the world who are living with diabetes, and that disease is growing at an alarming rate. You know, the International Diabetes Federation just issued its latest diabetes atlas, and it shows, I forget the precise number, but it's going to be close to 600 million people in the next 10 or 15 years if something isn't, you know, if we don't change the trend right now. And one of the things that's critical in understanding the nature of the diabetes epidemic today is that in many cases, depending on which country you take, most people who have diabetes don't know they have diabetes. You know, and this is not dissimilar to what we've seen in other disease conditions in the past, but a lot of what government can do is to work on the prevention side. I mean, the earlier you intervene, the less it costs, just as a general principle. So if we can just find ways to mobilize individuals and communities and patient groups and others to just get the word out to people, here are the things to look for, here are the risk factors, you know, here are places you can go to get advice if you think you might be ill, that actually is the first step on a path toward really finding a much more effective way to deal with more of these conditions. And then that relates to the last thing I'll comment on, the post-2015 discussions about where should health fit in the new set of sustainable development goals. And I think that, you know, the kinds of things we've been talking about today and that we address in this book have to do with, you know, the debate around universal health coverage, which has been at the core of this the discussions around what should the next set of sustainable development goals look like, have really dealt with questions about who should be covered, what should be covered, how much of that should be covered. But ultimately, governments and their partners are going to have to get down to the question of how do we actually do the things that we've decided should be covered under universal health care. And so I think that it's the kind of pragmatic suggestions that we've been talking about. How can you improve regulatory environments? How can you do better jobs, a better job on supply chains? How can you actually get primary care to cover more of the health conditions that affect people at that level? Those are all going to be relevant to really implementing the decisions that may be made around universal health coverage as a new sustainable development goal.
So I'll hit 1, 2, 3, actually. I'll start with our colleague over there because you sort of asked a pre-commercial question, which is that, you know, what do you do with you're in a new innovative technology space, and, you know, I mean, though we are the largest in our sector, the fact of the matter is 85% of the companies are small, medium-sized companies. A doctor has a great idea, they decide to perfect the idea. It's not starting with a lab scientist. So it's great. It's very clinically inspired, who then turned to an engineer, and we're very interested in those discussions. I think one of the parts that's actually been missed here is the fact that the finest innovations in to change this landscape, and by the way, to re-import into the United States, Samuel, you know, into the United States, are ones that actually started well overseas in very resource-poor economies. We're actually, that venture I talked to on kidneys is with Apollo. It is a private sector, largest private sector player in India, get the point. But still, I mean, that's a type of inspiring activity. We'd love to talk to you more about that. And I think that we need to inspire solutions that we can re-import into the United States. We've got a slight problem in terms of percentage to GDP that we're spending on healthcare. I think that might be a secret, but I'm not so sure.
Multilateral development banks, Jeff. I was a big critic of multilateral development banks until the high-level meeting. And we track, some of us, very closely. And here's my conflict of interest statement. We could actually commercially benefit from following those, and I'm declaring that out front. And I tell you, we actually follow those. We actually make money on those projects, okay? So just so you know that, okay? Conflict of interest in statement finished. I would say that you have a remarkable amount of leadership actually coming out right now from a different institutions. Islamic Development Bank, people don't think very much of. World Bank, certainly. Well, I got a very interesting email from some very high-level people at a very large IFI recently, people that I've been trying to engage for 3 years when we put our new commitment on the street, the philanthropy commitment on the street, and that was really helpful. But I think what you look in an obvious place, look at unilateral donors like Luxembourg. Our friends in Luxembourg have done some very, very important things, and let's look at them. But also look at the other UN institutions that actually have been tremendously responsive. And I mean UN Family Planning Agency, UNFPA. It's tied to the mother-child. Great leadership coming out of UNFPA. I got a solicitation the other day from UNHCR. They're talking about refugees and NCD education around UNHCR. It is a public solicitation, not top secret. Helen Clark, head of UNDP of all things, is almost risking her presidency, or I'm sorry, executive directorship on this discussion. I mean, let's be proud of those and let's celebrate those rather than necessarily talking about those that perhaps are less responsive. I think they'll come, and if not, Margaret Chan will track them down and find them, and if not, Ban Ki-moon will find them. To Ariella, I think on the 2015 discussion, post-15, 2015 discussion, certainly think it's very important. I think she was asking about the consistency point between us and perhaps with our external. I think to say the obvious, we've got a report on the street, which is a high-level eminent persons report. Please read it. Because it does have three references there to NCDs, and that's a lot, I was told by Homi Hamras. And so that gives some confidence that it's certainly in play. Exactly the how, and Jeff was talking about that to a certain extent, are very important. But I do, yesterday was opened up, I think, the largest ever global survey trying to solicit worldwide feedback on those post-2015 goals. So participate as well. Thousands have already done so in the context of this high-level persons report. Let's just make it right. Whatever form it takes, let's be participative. So thank you.
Thank you. I apologize to some of our listeners who are patiently waiting to pose questions. We're running out of time. I apologize. Perhaps you can engage some of our speakers after this. I want to close by first of all thanking my colleagues, Matt Fisher, Jessica Alpert, who did a very good close read of the book earlier, Alicia Kramer, Lindsay Hammergren, who've put a lot of time into making this event happen. I want to thank Raymond Martin, Tina Flores, who's Jeff's colleague, who's done a terrific job in preparing this and thinking this through. I want to congratulate the authors, the editors, the contributors to this volume. I think that you've really made a major contribution. It's, as Sally emphasized, this is pragmatism at its best. You've offered us 5 points, no more than 5 key points. That's incredible discipline. If you'd gone to 6, you would have lost me. And you have a framework. It hangs together, and it's driven by optimism, and it's driven by an appeal for leadership and for sort of practicality and sensibility. And I think a conversation is evolving. I think the conversation's evolving in very positive directions. And to significant degree, it's because of your leadership, Jeff, and Lou, and Trevor, and Sally, and many of you that are here in this room who are really at the center of this movement. So please join me in thanking our panelists, and thank you.